Good morning, everybody. My name is Ignacio Ramirez. I'll be your moderator for this morning's session. And welcome to Archetype Pattern Workshop. This is a school, and it is not a church, and neither are we affiliated with a church or religious organization. This school is a nonprofit, non-denominational, religious, and scientific research organization dedicated to proving the existence of Yahweh or Elohim and the operation of the eternal pattern, purpose, and plan operating throughout eternity unto this present day. Now, this school is the result of a divine panoramic vision and revelation given to Henry Clifford Kinley in the state of Ohio in the year 1931. Since that time, there has been schools established throughout the United States, Canada, and certain other foreign countries. Archetype Pattern Workshop was established in February 2021. Now, in these schools, we use and teach by the true and original names and titles for the Heavenly Father, the Word or Son, and the Holy Spirit, which are contained in the original Hebrew text. The true name for the Heavenly Father is Yahweh. It has been improperly substituted by Lord. The true title for the Word or Son is Elohim. It has also been improperly substituted by God. And the true name for the Holy Spirit, manifested in or out of a physical body, is Yahshua. It has been erroneously substituted by Jesus Christ. Lord and God, they are titles and not names. The Apostle Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, tells us in 1 Corinthians 8:5 that there are Lords many and Gods many. For we now know that each Lord must have a name, each God must have a name also. Elohim is a title, but unlike Lord and God, Elohim is a divine title. This means that Elohim is a title that our Creator chose for himself. Jesus is a name, but Jesus is an erroneous name. A minor investigation on your part into a good dictionary or encyclopedia would prove that the Hebrew language, the Greek language, nor the Latin language have any characters or letters in your alphabet that would produce the sound that is made by this letter J. Neither was there a letter J in the English language until some 1,400 years after the death of the Messiah. Therefore, such names as Jesus and Jehovah are impossible renderings for the true and original name of our Heavenly Father and His Son. Christ is a title, just like Lord and God. Now, Yahweh is pure spirit, and in this state, he's incomprehensible, inscrutable, and indiscernible. He is the ultimate source, substance, limits, and bounds of everything. We have Yahweh symbolizing this pure spirit state on this chart as a cloud. Yahweh is not a cloud. He merely chose the cloud to symbolize himself because the cloud has no particular or descriptive shape and form. We have drawn this cloud all around the edges of this chart to show you that everything on this chart is within the cloud. In like manner, everything in the universe abides within the pure spirit state of Yahweh. Yahweh, knowing that man could not perceive of him in this pure spirit state, took on shape and took on form right with himself as Elohim. This is the Word or Son, a super incorporeal being, that is, having the shape and form of a man, but without flesh and blood. And this shape and form can only be seen in a divine vision and understood in a divine revelation. Later on, the self-same spirit manifest himself in a physical body and walk the earth plane as Yahshua the Messiah, who the world calls Jesus Christ. Now, there's only one name given unto salvation, and we all must know this name. So the simple yet intelligent question we should ask ourselves is, what was the name of the Savior during the time that he walked the earth plane? A further understanding of this name and title could be had by reading a preface of the Holy Name Bible. Also in this school, we teach by the divine pattern of the universe. It is called a divine pattern because it is Yahweh's pattern. And after Yahweh led the children of Israel out of the land of Egypt, he called Moses on top of Mount Sinai and showed him a tabernacle pattern in a vision. And he instructed Moses to build one exactly like it in the wilderness of Sinai. Now this pattern consists of a most holy place, a holy place, and a court round about. These three compartments make up the one tabernacle pattern. And we go forth in this school to prove that everything in the universe moves and operates according to the structure and function of this threefold tabernacle pattern. Absolutely nothing escapes the pattern. Now, the 10 aims of the school are as follows. One is to help you find and know Yahweh or Elohim as he really is and as he actually exists. Two is to form a nucleus of universal brotherhood of humanity in Yahshua the Messiah without distinction of race, nationality, creed, sex, caste, or color. Third is to investigate the unexplained spirit law, or so-called law of nature, and the powers latent in man. Fourth is to encourage and promote the study of the scriptures, comparative religions, psychology, philosophy, modern, practical, and occult science. Fifth is to extirpate current superstitions, skepticism, and ignorance. Sixth is to learn, know, and understand the operation of Yahweh's eternal purpose through the dispensation and ages. And seventh is to discern and avoid being deceived by Lucifer, the serpent, the dragon, or Satan and his demons operating the mystery of iniquity on earth through the dispensation of time. And eighth is to earnestly contend for the common salvation of faith that was once delivered unto the sons or children of Yahweh. And ninth is to make known that Yahweh, from the beginning ordained, there is no other name given among men whereby man must be saved, saving the name of Yahshua the Messiah. And tenth is to inherit eternal life now in the kingdom of Yahshua the Messiah with the hope of immortal glorification in the newer state. Our watchword is peace. Our slogan, speak the truth. This morning we have prayer by Dr. Irene Ramirez. Our scripture lesson is Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Our scripture reader would be Dr. Nanette Ramirez. And we have a selection of music after the prayer.
Good day, class. We'd like to ask Yahweh our Elohim to give us the strength to go on, to give us that wisdom, to give us that knowledge according to his will. And we ask this in his son's name, Yahshua Messiah. Let's all say hallelujah.
This mountain so high I could not climb, for every step that I would take forward, Satan put me three steps behind. And there was this river so deep touched my soul so gently. It was Yahshua. When I cried out, he said, peace, be still, child, and let me lift you over, he said. grassland. The burdens got so heavy, and I changed my name to despair. In the darkness came a light and someone standing there. My Savior and His glory. I ran for comfort when He said, peace, be still, child, and let me lift you over. He said, peace, be still, child, let me make you my soldier for true. It's such beauty, yeah, yeah, wear it as your armor. He said, peace, be still, child, and let me lift you over and over and over and over. You should open, shed a knock at your door. I did, and I know just what I'm pressing toward.
Good morning, class.
Good morning.
My name is Nanette Ramirez, and I'll be reading from the Holy Name Bible containing the Holy Name versions of the Old and New Testaments, critically compared with ancient authorities and various manuscripts, revised by the late A.B. Trainer. I'll be reading Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Yahshua, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endureth the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of Yahweh. For consider him that endureth such contradiction of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin, and ye have forgotten the exhortation which speaketh unto you as unto children. My son, despise not thou the chastening of Yahweh, nor faint when thou art rebuked of him. For whom Yahweh loveth, he chasteneth and scourgeth every son whom he receiveth. If ye endure chastening, Yahweh dealeth with you as with sons. For what son is he whom the father chasteneth not? But if ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards, and not sons. Furthermore, we have had fathers of our flesh which corrected us, and we gave them reverence. Shall we not much rather be in subjection unto the Father of spirits and live? For they verily for a few days chasten us after their own pleasure. But he for our profit, that we might be partakers of his holiness, now not chastening for the present, seemeth to be joyous, but grievous. Nevertheless, afterward it yielded the peaceable fruit of righteousness unto them which are exercised thereby. Wherefore, lift up the hands which hang down and the feeble knees, and make straight paths for your feet, lest that which is lame be turned out of the way. But let it rather be healed. Follow peace with all men and holiness without, which no man shall see Yahweh, looking diligently, lest any man fail of the grace of Yahweh, lest any root of bitterness springing up trouble you, and thereby many be defiled. Lest there be any fornicator or profane person as Esau, who for one morsel of food sold his birthright. For ye know how that afterward, when he would have inherited the blessing, he was rejected, for he found no place of repentance, though he sought it carefully with tears. For ye are not come unto the mount that might not be touched and that burned with fire, nor unto blackness and darkness and tempest, and the sound of a trumpet and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them any more. For they could not endure that which was commanded, and if so much as the beast touch the mountain, it shall be stoned or thrust through with a dart. And so terrible was the sight that Moses said, I exceedingly fear the quake. But ye are come unto Mount Zion, and unto the city of the living Elohim, the heavenly Jerusalem, and to an innumerable company of angels, to the general assembly and congregation of the firstborn, which are written in heaven, and to Yahweh, the judge of all, and to the spirits of just men made perfect, and to Yahshua, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that sprinkleth better things than that of Abel. See that ye refuse not him that speaketh, for if they escape not who refused him that spake on earth, much more shall not we escape. If we turn away from him that speaketh from heaven, whose voice then shook the earth, but now he hath promised, saying, yet once more I shake not the earth only, but also heaven. And this word yet once more signifieth the removing of those things that are shaken, as of things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve Yahweh acceptably with reverence and fear. For our Elohim is a consuming fire. I have read Hebrews the 12th chapter. Let us all say hallelujah.
All righty, good morning once again. I take a couple of minutes here. The scripture lesson we read talks about a race, okay? And it's given to those that endure, okay? Now, we've been going through this chart right here, okay? What we're doing is looking towards the kingdom, or Yahshua. And we're running this race, okay? And it's not a race of speed, but endurance, okay? Now, when we get into, when we come into school, okay, when we're learning, we're running this race all together, okay? And the thing about it is, when the Holy Spirit is showing somebody something, you get excited, okay? You want to share it, but you're going, you know, towards Yahshua, okay? And we're using the pattern. Now, I know sometimes it gets a little heated in here, okay? For those out on social media experience this thing, you know, Will gets a little excited, okay? It's not new. I've known Will since 2006, somewhere around there, you know? And I know him, you know? It's just part of his, idiosyncrasies, you know, that we all have. But he gets excited, but he apologizes. You come to him, he'll apologize. I've seen it, you know. People get their feelings hurt, you know, and he doesn't mean it because he's showing you. If you can listen to the things that he's showing, you would understand what he's doing. You know, it gets, you know, hurry up with the scriptures, you know, because Yahweh's showing him something, you know. And we all go through it. I know I went through it a couple of times, you know. I get impatient, you know, because I don't want to forget what Yahweh's showing me, you know. So that's something, it's not personal to anybody out there in case they get their feelings hurt, you know. So we continue with class, go on learning. It reminds me, I told him one time, Will, you remind me of the old school teachers. Like we went to school in the 60s, early 60s. And there, if you screwed around in class or you messed up, you get your hair pulled, your ears pulled, or you get smacked with a ruler. That's the way it was. If it was bad enough, they had a paddle there, okay? You go to the principal's office, it got worse. There's always a paddle hanging there, and above that thing it says the Board of Education, you know? And, you know, that the principal or, you know, your counselor, whoever, is just looking at you, and, you know, he's probably laughing, you know, because that's the first thing you see is the Board of Education and a big old paddle. I know they stopped it in the 70s, you know, because somebody got their tailbone broke or something like that, and they were suing, you know, everybody. So they stopped it. All right, so contact Will, you know, if you feel bad about it, and he'll apologize. It's not, like I say, it's not personal. I've known him for years, you know, and that's part of this thing. He's an old school teacher, you know. All right, so with that, our next speaker will be Dr. Will Williams.
Okay. So I take it the other mic is not ready.
You can use it, but it's the one that has the
crackling. Oh, it's okay. All right. I hate holding mics.
I mean, you can use it, it still works.
Okay. Good morning, class. Let me get this out the way. It is indeed an honor and a pleasure to be here with you to learn more of this great and awesome, colossal, stupendous panoramic vision and revelation given to us by Yahweh our Elohim. And I appreciate the kind words by the moderator. I don't mean to be mean if I am, if I come off that way, I guess. Some cases I do mean it. So, only because I had a hard mother. If you knew my mom, boy. Anyway, this is a school and it's not a church, okay? The thing that I try to come across, or bring across rather, is that which Dr. Kennedy taught. And if we can get that scripture, I think it's in Isaiah, it says, remember the former things of old. Isaiah 40, 45, 46, somewhere. Yeah. You're saying the other microphone is not working that well? Well, let me try it, because I got to have my hands free. You know, I was like this at a seminar once. It had a cord, and I had to tie the cord around my neck. Yeah, it looked like a hangman's noose. You know? Oh, I like that. I can hear that. Okay. Yes. My hands are free to do. Do we have the scripture?
Yes, Isaiah.
Yeah, let's 46, hear
it. 9 and 10.
Uh-huh.
Remember the former things of old.
Mm-hmm.
For I am El, and there is none else.
Mm-hmm.
I am Elohim, and there is none like me.
Mm-hmm.
Declaring the end from the beginning, and from ancient times the things that are not yet done.
Mm-hmm.
Saying, my counsel shall stand, and I will do all my pleasure.
All right, that's good enough. All right, remembering the former things of old. And for me, personally, I try to remember the former things of old as far as what Dr. Kennedy taught, you know, initially, you know, especially in the late 50s, early 60s. Things that really you don't hear too much anymore. And people ask, well, how come you go into these certain subjects? Well, the reason why is because other people don't do it. I listen to the other classes, and I hear what they have to say, and I hear what they go into. And the thing that get me is, okay, what are they not talking about? Oh, well, they're not talking about science of mind. They're not talking about cosmogony. They're not talking about the sector of sanctum. They're not talking about these correlations with these plates. See, there's a lot of things they ain't talking about, you know, which to me, I'm like, if it ain't got nothing to do with this vision, then what is it that you're really talking about? All right? So that's my thing. I try to remember those things that Dr. Kinley taught, and I try to keep these things in memory because it's part of the doctrine that he taught as far as, yeah, it's part of the doctrine that he taught. All right? And the tenets that we embrace, the unity of the spirit, institution fulfillment, and the divine pattern of the universe. Everything falls into one of those categories, okay? Now, I thought about a topic today, but I'll ask you guys if y'all wanted to get into something particular. I know I've been asked to go into a couple of plates, but if you go back and look at some of the lectures we've done, we've covered some of these subjects. So I want to try to get into subjects that have not been covered as much, you know, or certain plates that we have not gone through, okay? Thursday was talked about Lucifer, about the war in heaven, so forth and so on. And incidentally, that subject came up in my stepson's minister's meeting. I don't know how it is that some of the subjects that he gets into ends up on this floor on Sunday. Kind of blows my mind, but I guess it's Yahweh's way of showing me and say, hey, well, here's something you could talk about, you know, on Sunday, you know, elaborate more, that kind of thing, because it's usually a question and answer session there, and he's entertaining these church people, and these church people, they're in a church, and it's like the preacher's there, and they're in this church, and it's like maybe 20 to 30 folks in this church that's listening on the Zoom class, you know, and so they ask questions, you know, about the doctrine, and my stepson, he'll field it to certain other people that he might feel could address it, you know, certain questions he'll address to me, you know, because they'll ask certain questions, particularly now, you know, about the state of the world, you know, today and the way it is. And see, to understand that, you're going to have to understand this chart, which is what a lot of people in class don't understand. See, you know, the Daniel chart, the map. I call it the undiscovered country. Okay, and there's a lot involved in it because it involves history. But Dr. Kinley was really a student of history, you know, based on what I have read in this textbook and the lectures he's given, you know, audios I've heard and the transcriptions of these audios. I mean, the man had a finger. He had his finger on history, no doubt. The Bible itself, to a certain extent, is a history book, if you look at it that way. And Dr. Kinley encouraged us to read the Bible. See, not so much that you can quote certain scriptures out of it, but to be familiar with what is in the Bible. Because to be familiar with what's in the Bible helps you become familiar with these charts. See, because everything that you see on these charts is in the scriptures. When we go through these plates, you want to look for the principles on these plates. The best way to find out what the principles are is simply read the scriptures or the story to what the plate is showing. Okay? Now, in saying all of that, I need to go somewhere. So I guess where I'm going to go is to the undiscovered country, all right, which is this chart, which is showcasing the mystery of iniquity on earth coming down after the degeneration in the first Adam coming down, all right, and then coming down through the ages and dispensations, all right, coming, here's Yahshua, the rock cut out of the mountain without hands to shatter that image, okay, all of that. But I have to lay a foundation because I really want to get into the modern era. I've tried this a couple other times past. I halfway got there, but I want to try to hopefully complete the picture, if I could put it like that, so you can understand more perfectly the events that's going on in the world today, okay? So, first an introduction, and I'll need plate 14, and let's get Revelations, the 12th chapter.
You want to start with the word?
Yeah, go ahead. You got the holy name?
Right.
Start with two.
Revelations 12 and 2.
Yeah.
And there appeared a great wonder in heaven,
mm-hmm.
a woman clothed with the sun
mm-hmm.
and the moon under her feet, and upon her head a crown of 12 stars. And she, being with child, cried, travailing in birth and pain to be delivered. And there appeared another wonder in heaven, and behold, a great red dragon, having 7 heads and 10 horns, and 7 crowns upon his head. And his tail drew the third part of the stars of heaven, and did cast them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman which was ready to be delivered, for to devour her child as soon as it was born.
Mm-hmm.
And she brought forth a man-child, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up unto Yahweh and to his throne. And the woman fled into the wilderness, where she had a place prepared of Yahweh, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. And there was war in heaven.
Uh-huh.
Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon fought in his angels, and prevailed not, neither was their place found any more in heaven. And the great dragon was cast out, that old serpent called the devil and Satan, which deceiveth the whole world. He was cast into the earth, and his angels was cast out with him. And I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now is come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our Lord and the power of his Messiah. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our Lord day and night.
All right. Good enough. Thank you much. All right. Now, that gives you a synopsis of what happened up here in the heavenlies, okay? That there was a war in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angel. A question was brought up to me once that said, well, does Satan set up a kingdom in heaven? My answer to that particular question would be no. But it does say in the textbook that he did set up a government. And see, and that's not hard to understand, because setting up a government is not necessarily the same as a kingdom, because the kingdom is Joshua and those other two-thirds who did not lose their first estate. But the government that he set up was simply him and that one-third setting up and say, okay, yeah, we up here. See, and that caused the war in heaven. Now, the question you want to ask is, well, how long did that last? Well, I could draw a line over here, because Dr. Kinley wrote in his textbook that King Saul was a type of that satanic rulership up here. All right, King Saul ruled for 40 years. 40 years, prophetically speaking, is 1 hour. Okay, and look, we can even get persnickety with this. See up here, see down here, this is the migratory trek here. All right, and we got the Israelites down here. This is before Moses comes down here. The 70 souls came down and multiplied. Okay. And then Pharaoh issued a death decree. See, why did he do that? Because he's looking for that one who was prophesied to come. So he killed all the boy babies, 2 and under. That's a physical example to understand what's happening up here. Because, see, in Egypt, Joshua, the son of Nun, was walking around down there. Now, you see, why? Because up here in the heavenlies, Joshua, the Messiah, or Elohim, walked around like any other Joe Blow angel. And they was looking for him. It's the same thing in principle. How do I know? Draw a line up here. See, when Saul was king, David, who had slew Goliath, was getting more praises from the people than Saul did. Because they were saying, well, Saul has slain his thousands, but David his tens of thousands. And so he got jealous. And he hunted after David. Hunted after the man. Why? Because just as Satan was up here looking for Elohim, who was in the form of another angel, just as Pharaoh down here in Egypt, see, was looking for Joshua down here. See, they were the devil, that is, incarnate in Pharaoh, looking for Joshua down here as Joshua, son of Nun. See, that's how you can correlate all of this. I could have went right here. Anyway, but yeah. See, that's the same thing. And see, that's why it's imperative to, one, understand the steps of the tabernacle pattern, steps of the migratory pattern, and simply read the Bible. Be familiar with the stories in the Bible, okay? Now, he's cast out, and I'm cutting this up because I really want to get somewhere, all right? He's cast out, and it said that woman. See, we read about the one who bore a son. See, that son, that was Adam. Okay? And see, and look, as long as, matter of fact, where are we at? No, I'll come back there. I'll come back. See, now, here's Adam created out of the dust of the earth. And he was breathed into my living soul. And he's placed in the garden, the spirit law, okay? Now, as long as like that, you don't see Satan up in here. But then after he's put into a deep sleep, talking about Adam, and an incision made, and the woman taken out, see, now here he comes. I don't know if you can see that. I want you to see that, yeah. Here he comes. See, sneaking into the garden to spy out their nakedness, okay? All right? So now, I'm just cutting this up because I'm getting to a point. Here, he deceives the woman. He appears to the woman. He's not incarnated in her, but he just appears to her. He appears to her, and then Adam is watching her, watching this tree. She takes the fruit, and nothing happens when she takes the fruit, but as soon as she gives it to Adam and they both eat, then the transgression happened. All right? Time begins, the sun is setting, they're kicked out, all right? Now, here we have Cain and Abel. Let's get the third chapter of Genesis, yeah. Because I want 3:15.
Genesis 3:15. And I will put enmity between thee and the woman.
I am going to put enmity between thee, talking about this serpent here, and the woman.
And between thy seed and her seed.
Uh-huh.
And shall bruise, he shall bruise thy head, and thou shalt bruise his heel.
Mm-hmm.
Unto the woman he said, I will greatly multiply thy pain and thy conception. In pain thou shalt bring forth children, and thy desire shall be to thy husband.
All right.
And he Brother, shall rule over thee.
All right, see. Now that's what happened. So now, this is when I said, dust shalt thou eat all the days of thy life. All right, so now he's going to incarnate first in Cain. See, he's not incarnating in Adam or Eve. See, that didn't happen. See, they were just cast out. But we look at Adam and Eve being cast out as a physical type and a shadow of Lucifer being cast out into the outer darkness. The sun is setting here. So they're being cast out of the creative age and being cast into the outer darkness of the antediluvian age. Okay? All right, so now you got Adam and Eve, all right? And here's Cain. He's the first human being that the devil is incarnating in. In fact, you could say that Cain is a product of the intercourse between Lucifer and Eve. Not a physical one, but a spiritual one. See? Because physically, Cain is the biological son of Adam. Okay? But spiritually speaking, because of his disposition, this is what happened, you know, there's an intercourse here, spiritually speaking, and then he's produced. So here's the devil incarnating in Cain. And then he went on and built the city of Enoch, okay, which we have here. He built the city of Enoch and instituted the way of Cain. In other words, he was worshiped. He became king and high priest, and that brought about the antediluvian apostasy. See, and it was the city of Enoch that Noah preached against for 120 years, all right? And then the flood happened, and that ended that age. And those demons, which you can't kill, see, they just crossed over into another age, and 101 years later, after the flood, they built the Tower of Babel, okay? And this is where Dr. Kinley talks about human government, because here, is where everything started at, as far as human government, the religions of the world, different, you know, iconoclast signs, and this, that, and the other. And this is where the languages were confused, because up to this point, it was only one language, which was Hebrew. But then after this event, you have multiples of languages coming out, all right? Now, Moses, who wrote the book of Genesis, wrote about the city, about Cain and the city of Enoch. Moses wrote about Nimrod and the Tower of Babel. All right, and let's read Isaiah 8 and 20. Let's get that in here.
Isaiah 8 and 20. To the law and to the testimony.
Mm-hmm.
If they speak not according to this word, it is because there is no light in them.
Now, to the law and to the testimony, what are we talking about? The law being the first five books of the Bible, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. The prophecy, the books from Joshua to Malachi. And look, when Moses wrote that, the prophets, whatever they had to prophesy about, had to draw out of what Moses wrote. All right? Had to be drawn from that. Now, that's why I mentioned, boy, that's why I mentioned Enoch and the Tower of Babel, because Moses wrote about them. Now we're going to go into the prophecy of the book of Daniel, where Daniel's going to draw out from what Moses wrote based on the vision that Yahweh's given Nebuchadnezzar. All right, Daniel 2:31. And see, and that's why I'm trying to show you the connection here. All right, now, Nebuchadnezzar had a dream, terrible dream, you know, and it was just so terrible, he went to his psychic friends network and said, you know, look, you need to interpret this dream I had, you know, because it was so terrible, it frightened me. And they were like, sure, O king, no problem, just just tell us what the dream is. And he said, well, I can't remember what the dream is. You need to tell me what I dream and the interpretation thereof. And they're like, well, sire, no, nobody can do that. And he said, well, somebody better do it, because if you don't, I'm going to kill you and your whole family. And so this kind of like set the palace aflutter. And so Daniel got word of it, and he entreated Yahweh. And Yahweh showed him what the dream was, showed him the interpretation thereof. And so now we find ourselves looking at Daniel. And Daniel is standing in front of Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, ruler of the world. And look, let me tell you something. Nebuchadnezzar, he's not like eye level. He's elevated. He's on a throne. You know what I'm saying? So Daniel got to look up. You know, I mean, he's going to bow, but then he's got to look up to him, you know, because he's on a throne, right? And so let's start reading, because he's going to explain to Nebuchadnezzar what it is he saw and the interpretation thereof.
Daniel 2:31.
Uh-huh.
Thou, O king, sawest, and behold, a great image.
Let me have plate 26. Let's just show that up here. Yeah, right here. Thank you. All right, go ahead.
This great image, whose brightness was excellent, stood before thee, and the form thereof was terrible. This image's head was of fine gold, his breast and his arms of silver, his belly and his thighs of brass, his legs of iron, his feet part of iron and part of clay. Thou sawest till that a stone was cut out without hands, which smote the image upon his feet that were of iron and clay, and brake them to pieces. Then was the iron, the clay, the brass, the silver, and the gold broken to pieces together, and became like a chaff of the summer threshing floors, and the wind carried them away, that no place was found for them. And the stone that smote the image became a great mountain and filled the whole earth. This is the dream, and we will tell the interpretation thereof before the king.
All right, hold it for a minute. Now, first, Daniel had to tell Nebuchadnezzar what the dream was, because remember, he didn't remember. All right, so he had to tell him. And look, while Daniel is telling this dream, the Holy Spirit in Daniel is bringing it back to Nebuchadnezzar's remembrance. So as Daniel is speaking, Nebuchadnezzar is reliving the dream in his mind while Daniel is speaking. And so as soon as Daniel finished what it was, Nebuchadnezzar in his mind has relived the dream. And he sees, oh, okay, I see what this is now. After what Daniel, you know, the Holy Spirit in Daniel told him. So now he relived. Now, okay, now that's the dream. Now he's got to tell him the interpretation of it. Go ahead.
37. Thou, O king, art a king of kings.
Mm-hmm.
For the Lord of heaven has given thee a kingdom, power, and strength, and glory. And wheresoever the children of men dwell, the beasts of the field and the fowls of the heaven has he given into thy hand.
Mm-hmm.
And thou hast made thee ruler over them all. Thou art this head of gold.
So you are the head of gold. See, you're at the top of this thing. Go ahead.
And after thee shall arise another kingdom inferior to thee, and another third kingdom of brass, which shall bear rule over all the earth. And the fourth kingdom shall be strong as iron. For as much as iron breaketh in pieces and subdueth all things, and as iron that breaketh all these shall he break in pieces and bruise. And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of the potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided. But there shall be in it of the strength of the iron, for as much as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay. And as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men. But they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay. Mm-hmm. And in the days of these kings shall the Lord of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed, and the kingdom shall not be left to other people, but it shall break in pieces and consume all these kingdoms, and it shall stand forever. For as much as thou sawest that the stone was cut out of the mountain without hand, and that it broke in pieces the iron, the brass, the clay, the silver, and the gold, the greater Lord has made known to the king what shall come to pass hereafter. Mm-hmm. And the dream is certain, and the interpretation thereof sure.
Okay. Now, this is the chart Dr. Kinley drew because of what we just read in Daniel. All right. When he drew this, the old folks, they used to call it the map. And the reason why is because if you look at it, it's what it is. It's a map of the old Roman Empire. See this red area? This is a map of the old Roman Empire. And England is on here because England was part of the Roman Empire. You can see there's a line up here, you know, that separates Scotland and England and Hadrian's Wall. You know, so England is, you know, England has history, you know, within the Roman Empire, okay? It was the most western and furthest northern part of the Roman Empire in its day, okay? So that's what the old folks used to call it, the map. Lee Warren, when he started getting into this chart, he was the one that came up with the term, the name Daniel chart. A lot of people say, oh, it's a Daniel chart, but most people don't know where it came. I'm telling you where it came from. It came from Lee Warren because of what we just read in Daniel about this dream here. And he called it that. And the reason why he called it that, because he had written a paper back in the early 80s called The Third World War, which I know about because I was there. In fact, my name is in the acknowledgement of that paper. All right. So if you want to know anything about it, you know, feel free to ask, because I was there when it was done back in, gosh, 1983. As a matter of fact, that was 40 years ago. So, and we studied the fourth volume. I mean, we really did. We got into the fourth volume. We studied the history. I'm talking about in class, in the downtown Chicago class. That was Lee Warren's class. At the time, I was president. Believe it or not, I was president of that class. So I know something about Lee Warren. What Iggy was saying earlier about hard instructors, let me tell you something, boy. Lee Warren was a taskmaster, all right? Because he would sit in that chair in the front row, and he'd get you up there. And, you know, you had to go through the basics. And, you know, you had to get the children of Israel out of Egypt. You know Abraham's promise, and then get them down to Egypt, and then get them up out of Egypt. I remember one time, and this one guy got up on the floor, and he was just going, him and just about everything, and, you know, and Lee Warren was timing, because he would time you, and he would just say, you know, and he would just, and he stopped the guy while in midstream up on the floor, and he said, look, he said, you've been up here 15 minutes already, man, when are you going to get these children of Israel out of Egypt? He said, when are you going to get them out? You know, I mean, you've been up here 15 minutes now. You know, they should have been up out of here by now. I know the scripture says they came out on eagle's wings. Is there a flight delay? That's Lee Warren. And, you know, and so you had to, there was a standard you had to do, because just the way he was, you know, because he was thorough in what he talked about as far as getting into the charts, the correlations, the numbers. Oh, my gosh. The guy was a CPA, so he knew about numbers, okay? So it was I appreciate my experience with him, because it forced me to really, you know, I didn't know what research meant until I met Lee Warren, to be honest with you. I just looked up stuff. But that guy knew about systematic researching, okay? But anyway, here, this is Daniel chart, because of the vision that Nebuchadnezzar had, which Yahweh showed Daniel, the vision and the revelation to which he conveyed to Nebuchadnezzar. Now, it didn't help Nebuchadnezzar out, because Nebuchadnezzar went on and built a statue 90 feet tall of gold and had people, you know, worship him, you know. As soon as the national anthem would play, you know, you had to, wherever you were at in the city, you had to turn in the direction of that statue and genuflect. And if you didn't do it, it was the fiery furnace for you, you know. So, I mean, there are a lot of things that you can look at in history that you see today. Like, we have a national anthem today, and people will get upset if you don't stand up. You know, salute the flag or put your hand over your heart or something like that. Because, I don't. I'll just be honest. If I'm at a place where I have to do that, I'll get up and leave. But if I'm stuck there, I'm not saluting no flag. And I'm a veteran too, buddy. Yeah. But I ain't saluting no flag. My only flag, the only banner I have is Yahweh. That's my banner. Now, mind you, hey, even Dr. Kinley said this, you know, we'll obey the laws of the land, you know, whatever they are, as long as it doesn't interfere with our divine right to worship Yahweh as he really is and actually exists. You standing up here telling me I got to salute a flag or put my hand on that's a violation of my divine right, because my allegiance is to Yahweh. That's my country, not America, not the, you know, Russia or Mexico or no other country, you know. Now, if I live there, yeah, I'll obey the laws. I mean, I'm going to get out here and drive and obey the laws and whatever, you know, pay my taxes. I'll do that. You know, but to say, you know, all to give you honor and glory, hell no, I'm not doing that. Because you're not my country. Simple as that. Okay? Now, here, let's get Daniel the 7th chapter, or it might be the 5th chapter in the Holy Name, because this is a confirmation vision that Daniel is going to receive concerning this vision that Yahweh gave to Nebuchadnezzar.
Starting at what?
Yes.
Daniel 5:1, in the first year of Belshazzar, king of Babylon,
mm-hmm.
Daniel had a dream and visions of his head upon his bed.
Mm-hmm.
Then he wrote the dream and told the sum of the matter. Daniel spake and said, I saw in my vision by night, and behold, the four winds of the heaven strove upon the great sea.
Mm-hmm.
And four great beasts came up from the sea, diverse one from another. And the first was like a lion, and had eagle's wing. I beheld till the wings thereof was plucked, and it was lifted up from the earth, and made stand upon the feet as a man, and a man's heart was given to it. And behold, another beast.
All right, hold it now. Here's this beast here. Now, the way Dr. Kinley's laid it out up here, he's showing you that this beast here corresponds with this head of gold in Nebuchadnezzar's dream. Okay? It's a confirmation of that, because Yahweh is showing it to Daniel, and he's confirming what he showed Nebuchadnezzar. Okay? But continue.
And behold, another beast, a second like to a bear, and it raised up itself on one side,
mm-hmm.
and it had three ribs in the mouth of it between the teeth of it. And they said thus unto it, arise, devour much flesh. After this.
All right, hold it now. Here's this bear here, and it corresponds with the arms and shoulders of silver here. The Medes and the Persians, okay? And also here, you see this hammer and sickle. This is the hammer and sickle. This is the old insignia of the USSR, the Union of Soviet Socialist Republics, all right? Which Russia was the main, I mean, there were 15 countries, but Russia was the main hub of it. And the symbol for Russia generally is a bear for Russia, you know, just like, the symbol for America is the eagle. The symbol for England is the bulldog. You know, so a lot of countries have different animals that, you know, portray their character, so to speak. The Russians like the bear because they say it portrays their character, okay, the best. And Dr. Kinley identifies that. That's why I put this hammer and sickle up here above the bear, which is, at that time, you know, which represents Russia. Okay, but continue reading.
6. After this, I beheld, and lo, another, like a leopard, which had upon the back of it four wings of a fowl. The beast had also four heads, and dominion was given to it.
All right, now this is portraying Alexander the Great. Because if you ever studied the military tactics of Alexander the Great, he had a small army that went up against larger numbers. So he had to use speed and, you know, surprise, and, you know, and he was good at it. And see, and conquered the Persian Empire, conquered Egypt and all that, and set up schools. And then when he died, he left no heir. So his empire was divided up among his four generals. See, his four generals being, let's see, Lysimachus, Cassandra, Seleucus, and Ptolemy. Ptolemy is the one that we know about because Cleopatra is a descendant of the Ptolemies. All right, and I make people angry when I say this. She was not black. You know, she was Greek. Because the Ptolemies, when they conquered Egypt, they adapted the pharaonic method. You know, they adapted the pharaonic, the pharaoh's, you know, religion. Because under the pharaoh's religion, see, the pharaohs believed in incest, brother-sister marriage. And people don't realize Cleopatra is a product of brother-sister marriage of like six or seven generations. In other words, she was an inbred. You understand? See, and so, you know, I remember Dennis Drulock told me about this once, and I thought he was crazy at the time until I really did the research. He said at this time when the Ptolemies took over, it was mostly a white hierarchy over a black population. And I'm like, you got to be crazy. Until I did the research, I'm like, oh, wow, he's right, because the Ptolemies were Greeks. See, and when they took over Egypt, him and his wife, he said, you know what, this Pharaoh thing ain't too bad. You know, we're gonna keep it all in the family. So when you children grow up, don't marry outside the family. Marry within yourselves and keep it all, within. And that's how Cleopatra come about. She is a product of inbred, because that's what the pharaohs of Egypt did, even in ancient times. Come out back there with Moses. They were doing it then like then there. We just don't accentuate on it, but that's what they did. See? That's why I can say, well, Cleopatra wasn't black. She was Greek, you know, and she was and she was the last. Oh, boy, we can get into this. I'm going to get into it in a bit. It's a very famous battle that happened right up here in the Aegean Sea that turned the Roman Republic into the Roman Empire. It was the Battle of Actium. It was it's a very famous naval battle. All right, where the forces of Octavian Caesar, who was the grandnephew of Julius Caesar, along with his general, who was a very famous man, his name was Marcus Vipsanius Agrippa. And matter of fact, he was so famous. Let me tell you something. He was so famous that, no, I won't get it. But Herod Agrippa, the one on that chart back there who killed James, the brother of John, his name was Herod Agrippa the First. Herod Agrippa, he was the grandson of Herod the Great. He was named after this general. That's how famous this guy was in that day. See? And they fought against the forces of Cleopatra and Mark Antony up here, near the island of Actium, the Battle of Actium in the Aegean Sea. And when they were defeated, that changed. They was able to conquer Egypt, and that changed the Roman Republic into the Roman Empire. Octavian Caesar became Augustus Caesar. See? I know my history. Up here, see, but that's what happened after Alexander, Levy and his four generals took over. They divided it up, and the Romans conquered each one of those generals, until they got to the Ptolemies. They were the last ones, and once they got rid of them, now you got the Roman Empire. Read.
7. After this, I saw in the night visions, and behold, a fourth beast, dreadful and terrible, strong exceedingly, and it had great iron teeth. It devoured and broke in pieces, and stamped the residue with the feet of it. Mm-hmm. And it was diverse from all the beasts that were before it, and it had 10 horns.
Had 10 horns, go ahead.
I considered the horns, and behold, there came up among them another little horn, before whom there were 3 of the first horns plucked up by the roots.
Mm-hmm.
And behold, in this horn were eyes like the eyes of man, and a mouth speaking great things. I beheld till the throne was cast down, and the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow.
That's in the Ancient of Days. That corresponds to that rock cut out of the mountains without hands. See, because Daniel is seeing this vision of these beasts, which is a confirmation of the vision that Yahweh gave Nebuchadnezzar. Okay? And here's the horn up here with the eyes of a man and a mouth. See, what it's showing you says Rome, but it's really showing you both Romes. Pagan Rome and Papal Rome. Okay? Is there anything else there?
Whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like the pure wool.
Mm-hmm.
His throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. a fiery stream issued and came forth from before him.
Mm-hmm.
Thousands ministered unto him.
A thousand, that's a million, right? You know, because somebody asked me, is Yahweh alone? No, he's never alone. He's surrounded by his witnesses. That's why he's called Yahweh of hosts. You know, he's always got his witnesses with him. Just like, you know, I don't know, I don't want to say gangster, but, you know, somebody walking, you know, they got bodyguards or, you know, attendants, you know, that kind of thing. Dr. Kinley had, though. I remember at the 75 convention, when I met him, there was a situation where people wanted to see him, and we was at the Hilton Hotel in Washington, D.C., a big hotel. It was in January. It was hot as hell outside, but inside it was like winter. I mean, they had that air conditioner kicking. But anyway, people wanted to see Dr. Kinley. I wanted to see Dr. Kinley, and I remember that I knew he had to come down. There was a long corridor, long hallway. He had to come down to an elevator. So I figured I'll sit, you know, wait for him at the elevator, you know, because he had to come out from these double doors about nearly a quarter mile down the hall, and, you know, come this way to the elevator. And see, and there was like a whole row of palm trees encased in concrete, you know, whole row of palm trees that went all the way down the hall. So I was sitting on this concrete enclosure under a palm tree so where he can come out. So when class was over, the double doors down there opened up, and Kinley walked out, and this is like this 79-year-old man, and he wasn't running, but he was walking real fast. And his handlers, you know, they were like in a little light trot trying to keep up with him, and the crowd, he left them behind. They were like, Dr. Kinley, and he just outwalked them. And then halfway down, they just kind of fell away because they couldn't keep up with him. But I'm sitting there waiting on him, you know, to, you know, come to the elevator. And he comes to the elevator, and he's got his back to me. And I'm sitting there, and I'm thinking, I'm like, okay, so this is Elohim in a body. And as soon as I thought that, he turned around and looked at me. It kind of startled me, you know. I was like, because I didn't expect that. I was like, oh, okay, so I kind of stood up, you know, I'm an ex-military, I kind of stood up at attention, and it was, sir, you know, and he nodded his head, and he smiled, and I swear, I could feel the warmth coming from this guy. I could just, like, the more he smiled, it made me smile, I could just feel it, this warmth, you know, and then he got on the elevator and just went up, and I was like, wow, that was interesting. And then, you know, and I told my friends about it. You know, I said, yeah, man, I ran into Dr. Kinley, you know, by the elevator, you know. And they were like, oh, no, man, ain't nothing. I met Dr. Gross, man, and that kind of thing. You know, because we were young, and we were new, and, you know, it was a great, you know, new experience, right? And so I'm thinking, you know, and they would say, well, you know, it's 2,000 people here. I'm sure, you know, he's going to be nice to everybody. And I'm like, yeah, you're probably right. So then the next session, the people that got outran by Dr. Kinley, they got smart. Instead of following him out the doors, they were outside the doors waiting for him, okay? And so it got to the point, it was so many people out there that the handlers came out, and they had to kind of organize this. They said, look, you know, everybody, you know, they just said, first they came out and looked at the situation, because there was like people out there. And they said, this is ridiculous. And they said, look, you folks, you guys got to make room for this. You know, why don't you come up with a line down this way, come up with another line down that way. Okay, now look, he's going to come out, all right? And look, you can speak to him, you can wave to him, but do not touch him, and do not impede his progress. That's what they told us, all right? There were so many people that, you know, I was like maybe halfway down the line, in this line, this double line, you know, because it stretched from the double doors all the way down to the elevator, which I said was nearly a quarter of a mile, seemed like, because it was a big hotel. And so I'm like maybe almost halfway down. I'm thinking, okay, and the double doors open. And when they opened, he came out, and the people erupted into joy. They just like, what? I said, Dr. Kinley, hi, Dr. Kinley. And he walked down. He didn't say nothing. He was walking, just walking. And, you know, and I'm thinking, you know, okay, I'm halfway down. He's coming. And I'm like, I'm thinking, well, he probably won't remember me from the elevator. So I'll just, you know, wave and, you know, just wave at him. And then as soon as he got close to me, I was getting ready to raise my arm, and he was like on the other side, you know, of the line. He was like, he looked at me and said, how you doing, my friend? And pointed at me, and I was like, what? And then it seemed like he took a giant step and got up right in my face, got right up in my face. He didn't touch me, but he was close enough, and we were eyeball to eyeball. And I was looking at him, and I was looking dead in his eyes, and, you know. And then it was like maybe, I don't know, good 5-10 seconds, and then he walked on. And, you know, because he asked me, how was I doing? And then as he walked off, I just said, fine, sir. You know, because it was a prayer to something that I had made many years ago, saying like, you know, look, you know, if you want me to meet you or know you, Yahweh, why don't you just, you know, you don't have to do anything fancy like send a tornado or lightning or anything. You don't have to do anything fancy. You know, here's something I think this is pretty easy for you. Why don't you just walk up to me and say hi and let me know it's really you? I had said that, you know, like several months, you know, before I even got to the, you know, even came into class. I said, well, yeah, why don't you just walk up to me and say hi and let me know it's really you. And that's what Dr. Kennedy did. He walked up to me and said hi, and he got in my face, eyeball to eyeball, and I swear, you may think I'm crazy, but I glimpsed eternity. I know that sounds crazy, but I did. I had never seen, and I'm an ex-hypnotist, and I've never seen a clearer set of eyes on a human being than I did on Henry Clifford Kennedy. I mean, it was clear, crystal clear. It was like, gosh, the only thing I could describe it, there was a movie that came out not long afterwards. It was a movie starring Barbara Streisand and Omar Sharif. And the movie was called On a Clear Day, You Can See Forever. And that's how I felt. That was the best way I could describe it. You know, I said, man, like on a clear day, you could see forever. And I looked through his clear eyes, and it was like I could see eternity. And I was like, wow, you know, and it just let me know, you know, that, you know, this is who he said he was. You know, and I still believe that. And it's still very imprinted in my mind to this day about that. Okay? But yeah. but that's how, yeah. I don't know why I got into that, but it just felt good to express that. You know, the power of Yahweh, you know, and I mean, oh my gosh, you know, that's why I'm into these charts like I am, man, because I know this is the result of a divine vision and revelation, and this is what he taught. And he went out of his way to really put all this thing, put this out there so that, you know, you wouldn't have an excuse for not knowing Yahweh as he really is and actually exists. If you take the time to look. See, that's the thing. Isaiah 27:1, because I know I pontificate a little bit of that. And I try to keep my pontifications down to at least 10% of the lecture, you know, because then you can go overboard and it feels good and it's all nice, but does it, you know, but it's like cotton candy to a certain extent. I like to get into the meat of things, you know, so something that'll stick to your ribs, something that'll, you know, put something on you spiritually speaking, you know. Yes.
Isaiah 27:1.
Mm-hmm.
In that day, Yahweh with his sore and great and strong sword shall punish
Leviathan. That's this right here. Read.
The piercing serpent.
Mm-hmm.
Even Leviathan, that crooked serpent.
Mm-hmm.
And he shall slay the dragon that is in the sea.
Now he's going to slay the dragon that's in the sea. What sea? Mediterranean Sea, Caspian Sea, Black Sea, no, the Sea of Men, the human sea. See, that's because, remember, we said that Satan was, he was cast out and he was incarnated in man, see? First Cain and then the rest of the human race. Incarnated, see, out of the Sea of Men, that's where these empires come from, out of the Sea of Men. See, go ahead.
Two, in that day sing ye unto her,
mm-hmm,
a vineyard of red wine.
Uh-huh.
I, Yahweh, do keep it.
Mm-hmm.
I will water it every moment. Lest any hurt it, I will keep it night and day.
All right. Now, see, it's Yahweh that's running this. See, the devil, the mystery of iniquity, is not a free moral agent. He's controlled by the purpose. He has a part to play in the purpose of Yahweh like everything else. And he's an asset at it. And he's good at what he's doing. See, he's good at it. Supposed to be. He has to be, otherwise he wouldn't be a worthy adversary unto Yahweh. He's got to be good at what, I mean, you know, yeah, he has to be. He's got to be a worthy adversary, okay? Now, that's in the prophecy. Now we want to get to Revelation 13:1, you know, to see how John is confirming what Daniel is writing.
Revelation 13:1.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw a beast rise up out of the sea,
mm-hmm.
having 7 heads and 10 horns,
mm-hmm.
and upon his horns 10 crowns,
mm-hmm.
and upon his head the name of blasphemy.
Mm-hmm.
And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard.
So like unto a leopard, here we read that.
And his feet were as the feet of a bear.
See, we read that.
And his mouth as the mouth of a lion.
We read that. So Daniel is being confirmed by what John is writing in Revelations about these empires. Okay, go ahead.
And the dragon gave him his power,
mm-hmm.
and his seat and great authority.
Mm-hmm.
And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death.
One of his heads that was wounded to death. This one. It's pagan Rome, this one. One of his heads wounded to death. How do we know that? Remember, we read about the rock cut out of the mountains without hands. Yahshua the Messiah is that rock. See, that rock happened here. We got it right here. It's death, burial, resurrection, ascension. Kingdom of Satan abolished. Kingdom of Yahweh restored. Was wounded to death by Yahshua. Because no mere meat man can wound the devil.
Right.
See? Yahshua is the one that wounded the devil. He did this with his death, burial, resurrection. Remember, because the day he resurrected and those souls who believed resurrected with him, that day Satan was incarnate and his host was incarnated in the scribes and Pharisees, and they sequestered themselves in the temple that day and didn't come out. Why? Because they were wounded. They were wounded to death because by him. But read.
And all the world wondered at the beast.
Mm-hmm.
And they worshiped the dragon, which gave...
Wait a minute, I missed the line. Read that again.
Right. And his deadly wound was healed.
His deadly wound was healed. All right, his deadly... Now, how that deadly wound... Now, he was wounded here. His death, Yahshua's death, burial, resurrection, and sin. This is where it was wounded. Then down the line, it was healed. How was it healed? Okay. My little water angel. Thank you, my dear. Now, it was wounded, and look, let me explain something here, because people will look at these plates down here, and don't understand, well, why is this pagan Rome dragon, why is it here on the plate with Stephen being stoned? And then we got the leopard over here, see, like the same way. Well, see, Dr. Kinley is showing you on these two plates that pagan Rome gave its power to papal Rome. Now, that, in principle, this is representing King Herod Agrippa the First. Remember the one who I told you was named after the commander. He was named after him, okay? So now, he was king over Israel. How did he become king? It was the Roman government that made him king or gave his pagan Rome. Because see, look, draw a line. Here's Yahshua on the cross. The scribes and Pharisees, under their law, condemned him to death. But they did not have the power to execute him. They had to go to Pilate to do that. Mm-hmm. Because he was the governor of Judea under the Romans. So they didn't have the power to execute him. They had to ask Pilate. And Pilate was like, well, I find no fault in him, you know. But then they kept saying, you know, well, he said he was the king of the Jews, and we have no king but Caesar. See? And so then they had a tradition where they had to release somebody, Barabbas. They said, well, look, you know, I'll release somebody. And Barabbas was in there for sedition, causing an insurrection, and murder. What he did was he killed a Roman official in an insurrection. He caused an insurrection up there, and in the process of the insurrection, Barabbas killed a Roman official. That's why he was in jail. Well, I said, well, you can choose either one. You can have Barabbas, who's a murderer and a seditionist, or you can have this Yahshua, who's king of the Jews. And they said, well, give us Barabbas. Hmm. See? And so Yahshua took the place of a murdered man. In other words, when he was executed, they couldn't execute him for nothing. He took Barabbas' place. So he was executed for sedition, insurrection, and murder. Talking about Yahshua, because he took Barabbas' place. See? But that's the power, see? But here, they're stoning Stephen to death here. Now you say, well, whose permission did they get from them? Well, see, here's the thing. They had already killed Yahshua. And Yahshua according to their description, was a leader of a sect of Nazarenes. And so they said, well, you already executed Yahshua, the leader. We're just mopping up the elements. You know, like Stephen here, we're just mopping up the elements. Because you already executed the leader of the sect, this one Yahshua who said he was king of the Jews. Well, these are people who believed in it. We're just cleaning that up. See? But now here, King Herod, he's made king over the Jews by the Romans. So he didn't have to ask any permission to execute James. He just did it because he had Roman soldiers backing him up. Okay? But that's the point I'm trying to show, that pagan Rome gave its power and authority to papal Rome. Now, when did that happen? That happened at this event. The Battle of Milvian Bridge. And you say, now what is that? This is where Constantine is going to fight against another emperor, you know, for supremacy of the Roman Empire. And so the night before the great battle, Yahweh gave Constantine a strong delusion. This is what Constantine saw. He saw the sun, the S-U-N, and he saw a symbol beneath the sun that looks something like this. All right, that looks something like that. And words in Latin, because he was a Latin man. So words in Latin. And the words were, in hoc signo vinces. This is a Latin phrase. It simply means, in this sign, conquer. This sign. Now, if you know anything about the Catholic Church, you know that they have, because they say that Peter was given the keys to the Catholic Church. All right. But what do those keys look like? Well, they had to come up with an idea. They took this symbol from Constantine, and see, and this is what they did. See, and they made keys out of it. And they turned the P into a crown, like a crown, you know. And so go look at the symbol of the Vatican. And you'll see this, and where they got it from is from this, from Constantine. See, because pagan Rome gave its power to papal Rome. Constantine was also the one that legalized Christianity in the Roman Empire, made it a state religion, see, and elevated. So that when the Roman Empire fell, it was the church that filled the vacuum, see. But the preparation had already been made because all the church did was just take on the framework of the Roman Empire. See, a lot of stuff, you'd be surprised that they use certain terms in the church they got from pagan Rome. Like, for example, the title, Pontificus Maximus. That's what the Pope is called. The first Pontifex Maximus was Augustus Caesar, because that was the title he had, that the Senate of Rome gave him. See, the idea that the Roman Empire, pagan Roman Empire, was divided up into regions called dioceses. Well, that's what the church did. They assumed that. They said, well, now we have the diocese of this, that, and that. Well, where did they get it from? They got it from the Roman Empire. They took on the trappings of that. See, in other words, pagan Rome gave its power to papal Rome. And that deadly wound was healed, and the world wondered after the Roman Catholic Church. Okay? Now, as we said, history is a threefold thing. History, you have ancient history, you have medieval history or the Middle Ages, and then you have the modern era. That's threefold. Ancient history is a long, like I say, from the gate to the door is a long walk. Because ancient history is a long walk. It started from the fall of Adam and Eve, 4000 BBY, until 476 AD, which is the fall of the Western Roman Empire. And then that's when the barbarians came in, you know, the Visigoths and, you know, all these other, you know, barbarians, the Huns and all, they came in, sacked Rome and took over, okay? But the church, see, during this time, the medieval time, they took over. See, they filled the power gap. See, in fact, it got to the point that in the medieval time, the church was able to put forth a person as emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. For example, during this time in the Middle Ages, you had the rise of the Muslims, like the Ottoman Empire. And they conquered not only Turkey and parts of the Balkans, but all across North Africa, even into Spain. They had conquered Spain, and they were into France. They were. I'm talking about the Muslims. They got as far as France, you know, until they were stopped by this one person. And this is a very famous battle that you should know about. It's called the Battle of Tours, France. This is where this one guy, very famous guy. Very famous general. His name was Charles Martel. He was the one who fought at the Battle of Tours to stop the Muslim advance into Europe. All right, that was as far as the Muslims got. The Muslim army. He stopped him. Incidentally, Charles Martel happens to be the grandfather of the first Holy Roman Emperor. His name was Charlemagne. That was in the year 800 when the Pope crowned Charlemagne Holy Roman Empire. He's the grandson of this guy, Charles Martel. See, so, you know, they have warrior spirit and all that kind of stuff. But this was a very famous, you can read about it, this very famous Battle of Tours, France, where they stopped the Muslim advance. And see, from that point on, they had to keep pushing the Muslims south, out of France, back into Spain, and eventually push them out of Spain. That happened with the marriage of Queen Ferdinand and Isabella. See, they were of Aragon and Castile. There were two kingdoms. They were rulers of two kingdoms. When they got married, their kingdoms combined together. That made up Spain. And see, and this was just before Columbus's voyage, and they were able to kick the Moors out of Spain by 1492. See, all this stuff is in the history books if you take the time to look at this stuff. Now, this sets up the modern era, because the medieval time, see, you can place that from 500 AD to about 1500 AD, the beginning of the Reformation and the Renaissance, all right? And the modern era, you can start it at about 1500 AD. So really, we've been in the modern era like 500 years now. Okay, and you can look at it by the pattern. Like I said, from the gate to the door is a long way, and then here's the holy place here. That's a big apartment, a big compartment, you know, 1,000 years. And then the most holy place is a shorter compartment than this. So therefore, we've only like 500 years in the modern era. Okay, now, the modern era began with a bang, because in the medieval times you had certain inventions that happened, like gunpowder and other discoveries and stuff of sailing and things like that. And people began to explore the world a lot more. You have this map. Okay. Yeah. See, people began, see, here in Europe, here's Europe. All right. Now, here, as I said, the Ottomans, you know, with the advance of Islam and Muslims, see, it used to be, back in ancient times, there was, you know, a trade routes going from the Roman Empire to China. You know, they've established that. You know, products from China, like silk, the stuff would get to Europe because people like that. Likewise, the Romans, they knew how to produce glass products And so glass products would get to China. And they loved that too, you know. But then when the Muslims took over, see, they occupied this land between, they cut off all the trade. Oh, in other words, they said, well, if you want to trade between, you got to pay our fees. And it was, and they were exorbitant. So people began to say, well, look, there's got to be another way to get to the east. So then they start building ships and start trying to find a naval route. You know, like the Portuguese, they began sailing. People like Bartolomeo Dias, you know, start sailing around. And then they began to find out, oh, this big African continent has an end. They could come around Africa and they can get to the Orient, to the east like that. They began to find that out, okay? Also, at the same time, the slave trade began to increase. It was the Portuguese that did that. And they did that because, and I got to find it, a pope gave an edict saying that it was okay to enslave these Muslims or non-Christians, okay? That's what they said, because see, what they did was the Portuguese would come down the coast of Africa and they would literally raid whole tribes and take them as slavery, and take them into slavery. Other tribes that heard about what the Portuguese was doing, especially when you get down here, they just said, well, look, they approached the Portuguese when they came and said, look, instead of taking us as slaves, you know, there's a lot more people on the interior. You can just set up a fort here. We'll go in and get them, and we'll bring them to you, and we'll trade them, you know, to you for whatever goods you got, guns, cloth, whatever. And that's how that got started, because of the demand for labor, because once they discovered these two continents over here, all right, and see, and they had to realize, see, Columbus didn't realize it. You know, he didn't get to China, you know. It's like the old Native American joke. Who was that? The guy, he was, I bet it was, what's his name? He's dead. Oh, gosh. He was an actor. Russell Means. He's an Indian. He was the head of the AIM, American Indian Movement. His name was Russell Means. He had a great joke. I used to love to quote him on, because he would always talk about, you know, everybody talk about Columbus discovering America. He didn't discover America. What happened was he got lost, and we discovered him. That's what they said. See, they still say it. Yeah, they sure do. They still say it. All right. And so, but Columbus didn't realize it. It wasn't until other explorers, like this, particularly this one explorer, his name was Amerigo Vespucci, and he was an explorer, and he explored, you know, parts of South America and stuff. And he realized that this is not China. This is a new landmass, you know. And so when he made his findings and discovery, map makers just took the name. Well, Amerigo Vespucci said this is a new continent, so we'll name the continents after him. America. That's how we got the name. You can look him up, Amerigo Vespucci. He was a map maker. Okay? And that's how we got the names America. All right, so now they began, so people start, you know, trying to find these different routes, and then they came into America. Some folks found gold, you know, like what's the guy down here and with the Incas? Pizarro. Yeah, he found gold there, and you know, and they exploited it, and they did. And see, and the Portuguese were the ones who mapped the world first. They found it was Ferdinand Magellan. He found that he found out that by going all the way down to the end of South America, he found these straits that he could go through and get into the Pacific Ocean, and then sail across the Pacific Ocean to China. The problem was he didn't realize how big the Pacific Ocean was, and his men just nearly starved to death. He got killed on an island out here near the Philippines, okay? But his men was able to navigate and circumnavigate the world and come back to Portugal and report, oh, hey, you know, there is a way we could do this. We can go all around the world and come around and, you know, and come back here. So now they discovered that, you know, this, which they call the Straits of Magellan. And seeing on the western side of South America, you had the Inca Empire. And they discovered that the isthmus of Panama was thin, that they could cross over. So the Spanish kind of had a monopoly on the west side, you know, of South America with the Incas, gold and all, until they got into a war with the English. All right, and the English found out about it, particularly Francis Drake. And I always thought he was the greatest pirate of them all, because what he did was he was commissioned by England to raid these Spanish ships. And he raided one ship that had a map that would take him through the Straits of Magellan and all the different ports on the west side of South America. And he hit them all, you know, and took their gold, because he had five ships, and he hit them all and took their gold and silver and goods and all. And so they figured, well, he's got to come back through the Straits of Magellan to go back to England. And he said, what are we going to do, Captain? They'll be waiting for us. And he said, he had this very famous quote, we will circumnavigate them. Meaning we're going to, instead of going back the way we came, we'll just sail around the world on them. Yeah. You know, sail around the world and go back the other and just avoid them. And which they did. And brought back all this goods to England, which they was able to build a ship, you know, build a fleet, because Spain got mad under Philip II, and he sent the famous Spanish Armada after them. And that's the reason why we speak English here today, because the English won. Had they won, we'd all be speaking Spanish, okay? See, that's just how history flows, you know, like that. And so once, and see, and this was during Queen Elizabeth.
Yeah.
All right, now I'm getting ahead of myself, because I got to go back over here. And I got to explain England on that map over there. Because Queen Elizabeth was the daughter of Henry VIII. Henry VIII, as most people know, had six wives. But the reason why he had six wives, because he was looking for an heir, you know, to succeed him. And so to get a divorce, so he had to get a divorce from the Catholic Church, which they weren't going to allow, or get an annulment at the very least, which he did for his first wife. And she married another, and he married another, and had a son named Edward. But he was sickly, right? And he didn't last long. Had another daughter, was with Mary, and she was, she was Roman Catholic, because England, Henry VIII, when the Roman Catholic Church wouldn't disannul another marriage, he wouldn't do it. So he just said, well, you know what? I'll just break away from you, right? And he created the Church of England, the Anglican Church. Right, which is really a mirror image of the Roman Catholic Church. There's just very little differences between them. The only difference is that the king or the queen of England is the head of the church, and that the priests are allowed to marry. Right? Other than that, they have the same liturgy, you know, and all that. They're pretty much the same. It's just that it's an Anglican church. Right? That's why it says wife up here. It says wife here. It says husband here. Because Henry VIII divorced himself from the Roman Catholic Church. Who was the husband, see? Okay? Now, England, the ascendancy of England, and it goes into what historians call the Age of Enlightenment. See, and in the Age of Enlightenment, you had people like John Locke, Thomas Hobbes, that professed their view of what government should be like. All right, how people should be ruled. And it's not a new thing. You can go all the way back to the Greeks, because they wrote about it, like Aristotle and Plato. They wrote about the ideas of government, democracy, the republic. The Romans had ideas. They borrowed from the Greeks. See, the ideal of a Roman republic, because they wrote about it. The United States, see, people try to tell you that, well, George Washington and all of them were very religious people and all this kind of stuff, and it's just a lie. They weren't. They were deists, okay? You know, they were good Christian people. No, they were deists. See, and deism is a belief that God, so to speak, you know, created the world and all, but he has a hands-off approach to it. He has a hands-off approach to it, and so therefore, they, being deists, they say, well, since God is not interfering into the world, we shall do it, all right? Because when they came to the New World, what they call the New World, which is North and South America, the Old World being Europe, of course. So George Washington, Ben Franklin, Thomas Jefferson and all, they said, this is what they said, let's see, seclorum. Seclorum novus ordo. That's a Latin phrase, and you can find it on every dollar bill. It just simply means order of the new world. See, or new world order. Because people say, oh, the new world order has come. Dude, George Washington and them talked about this. The order of the new world. See, that's this country. See, you know, it's not some foreign entity. That's America. And George Washington, they were the ones that came up with this. Why? Because they said, and listen, you can go back and read, when James Monroe became president, he issued what was called the Monroe Doctrine. He said that the United States had the right and the authority to make sure that no interference from outside countries, particularly from Europe, would come into the Americas, North or South America. It's still on the books, the Monroe Doctrine. And say any foreign country, we have the right to step in there and do something about it. Because we're the ones, we're the ones that have the order of the new world. Or this hemisphere. That's what they said. Okay? So now, I'm getting up to, I know I'm looking at the time. Now, Dr. Kinley, when he wrote his textbook, he talked about the mystery of iniquity and how Satan's kingdom is divided against itself. And what he said was that it's divided along ecclesiastical lines and along communist lines, the communism. Now, if we go back and we read in Daniel, maybe we can go back and read that again. Just read this one verse. It's in the second chapter of Daniel. It's in the second chapter, because we did read it. Read 2 and 42. Wait a minute. Read 41. 2 and 41.
Go. Daniel.
2 and 41. And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of the potter's clay. And whereas thou sawest the feet and toes, part of the potter's clay and part of iron, the kingdom shall be divided, but there shall be in it of the strength of the iron, forasmuch as thou sawest the iron mixed with miry clay. And as the toes of the feet were part of iron and part of clay, so the kingdom shall be partly strong and partly brittle. And whereas thou sawest iron mixed with miry clay, they shall mingle themselves with the seed of men, but they shall not cleave one to another, even as iron is not mixed with clay.
Okay, now, the toes of this image mixed with part iron and part clay. It said, now, they will adhere to men, but they will not adhere to each other. This is representative of the ecclesiastical world and the communist world, or the Marxist world, because both ideologies will adhere to men, but they will not cleave to each other. And in fact, Roman Catholicism and communism is at odds with each other. See? You can go to the textbook. Go to volume 4. Page 4, volume 4, page 81. See, Dr. Kinley addresses it, right, in his textbook. Yes, go ahead.
Papacy and the Russian Kremlin, or Satan divided against himself. The papacy, see the Vatican, is again trying to dominate the world, and the Russian Kremlin is trying to do likewise. Both follow the same structural pattern. The papacy with its pagan doctrines, or the so-called religious and political forms of universal government, and the Russian Kremlin from the so-called materialistic and political forms of government, both have been mortal enemies since 1917, when Lenin and Trotsky launched the world's first socialist Soviet Republic. At the same time, 1917, the papacy received a strong delusion, that is, the apparition of the Blessed Virgin Mary, with the message from Yahweh, as described in the miracle of Fatima. The new government of Russia was always hostile to ecclesiastical power, and the Vatican was only the villain in its religious rogues gallery. Its policy was flatly and unashamedly anti-religious, and had described religion as an opiate and as a counter-revolutionary force. See also Fatima and the Rosary, page 5, by Reverend Joseph Casella, Imprimatur Francis J. Spellman, D.D., Archbishop of New York. From 1917 forward, the new government of Russia began to lay plans for its materialistic and political domination and world conquest, only to be temporarily interrupted by two world wars. But since that time, she has renewed the effort and stepped up the pace through political propaganda and the Cold War. See picture taken from Russian magazine, opposite page 88. Likewise, as there heretofore stated, it has always been the prophetically described disposition of the man of sin or son of perdition operating the mystery of iniquity from the Garden of Eden to this present time, now disguised as the Pope of Rome, to skillfully use carefully planned political propaganda and religious deception in the name of God in an effort to dominate and force the overthrow of the ecclesiastical and political government of the world. The Pope is the supreme judge of the law of the land. He is vice regent of Christ, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. The Pope, by virtue of his dignity, is at the summit of both powers, the temporal and spiritual, from Civilita Catholica, Calcutta. I don't know what that.
Okay, good March enough. 18th. All right, good enough. All right, just pause there. Now, that's what's happening in the world. This is what Dr. Kinley's explaining. See, that these two forces are at each other's. You know, they're of the devil, but Satan's kingdom divided against itself. The Pope, see, what we read, he got his idea way back in the 13th century. Unam Sanctum. This is a doctrine that was given by this Pope. His name was Pope Boniface VIII, and he issued a papal bull called Unam Sanctum. In the bull, he said that the Pope has all ecclesiastical authority over the earth, meaning he has power over all souls, and he has temporal power over all the earth, meaning he's over all the governments. That's why I said back in the year 800, they crowned Charlemagne, the Pope did, crowned Charlemagne Holy Roman Emperor. So therefore, we have the power to crown emperors and kings, and we have the power to uncrown them. Okay? He was the guy that came up with that. See, if you look at it, go back to Revelation 13th chapter quickly, because I need to show you the reason why I'm going to do this. If you remember where you left off at. 13 and, start with 4.
4.
Yeah.
And they worshiped the dragon which gave power unto the beast.
Mm-hmm.
And they worshiped the beast, saying, who is like unto the beast?
Mm-hmm.
Who is able to make war with them?
Mm-hmm.
And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And power was given unto him to continue 42 months.
All right. Now, if you remember, we went through this. About time, times, and dividing of times. Remember? 42 months, which is the same as 1,260 days, which is the same as 3.5 years. All right? Now, this Pope here, let's just look at it like this. In A.D. 34, as far as the devil's concerned, he doesn't see Pentecost. This is Yahshua's birthday, as far as he's concerned, because he don't see A.D. 33. See, he sees A.D. 34 because Yahshua is physical, see, and he's doing everything physical. So now, He says 40 and 2 months, which is the same as 1,260 days. Now, if we was to take prophetic time a day for a year, see, and add that 1,260, and that would give you 1,294. It would give you 1294. It would give you AD 1294, which happens to be the year this guy issued this bull. Okay? Now, you're still in 13th chapter? Read 18th verse. Because it's 42 months. Now, read the 18th verse.
Here is wisdom.
Mm-hmm.
Let him that hath understanding count the number of the idol of the beast. For it is the number of a man,
mm-hmm.
and his number is 600, 666.
Now his number is 666. Just make it plain. Mm-hmm. Now let's use prophetic time and take that number 666 and make it 666 years. Now when we add that to this, that will take us to A.D. 1960, which is the end of this present kingdom age. See, and a year later, Dr. Kinley wrote his book, God the Archetype, and went and pointed his finger at the beast, saying, you know, this is the beast man of sin, at the end of the age, 1960. See, that's right there in the scriptures, okay? This is when, you know, we just showed you that, okay? And seeing this papal bull stuff, you know, a bull, what is a bull? You know, I used to thought it was just a, you know, male cow or something. No, a bull. See, the word bull comes from an Italian word. The Italian word is bulla. A bulla in Italian is a clasp, because they would issue a proclamation, the Pope would, write it out on a parchment, and then they would roll it up, and they would seal it in a clasp. That clasp was called a bulla. That's why I said, oh, well, here comes the papal bull. They just said that as a short. But the bulla was the clasp by which, you know, the edict was issued and, you know, was held in. We use this word. This happens to be the root word of a word we use in English, you know, all the time. And that word is this one. A bulletin. The root word of it is these words. See, that's the word we use in English, a bulletin, which is what? A short, you know, flash, you know, all right, you know, just like, here comes the paper bull. Oh, here comes a news flash. We got a news bulletin. It's the same thing, okay? Now, seeing that, these are the two forces. And we also read in the textbook that religion is an opiate and a counter-revolutionary force to a Marxist. So when people, see, most people don't know what Marxists are, because they'll say a certain, oh, you're a Marxist, you're a socialist, you know. And a true Marxist is an atheist. A true Marxist is an atheist, because you can't believe in God, you know, and being a Marxist, because, see, a Marxist, look, Dr. Kinley said this once in a lecture. He talked about the materialistic-minded Russians. I was in a transcript, one of the early transcripts. And see, and the reason why he said that, because see, in Marxism, see, the man who came up with the idea of Marxism was a man named Karl Marx, who was an atheist Jew. You can believe that. Him and another man named Friedrich Engels, all right, they came up with the Marxist, and what it was, Karl Marx was a historian. And he looked back on history, and he looked at what was called the materialistic view. Materialism. See, the materialistic view of history. In other words, from a Marxist point of view, there's no such thing as metaphysical. We believe in the physical, but metaphysical, something beyond the physical, no, they don't believe that. In fact, if you say, well, I hear voices, you know, God is talking to me, they'll just think you're crazy. You hear, you know, because to a true Marxist, there's nothing beyond the physical, you know, the solid, you know, liquid and gas. There's nothing beyond that. Materialism is the reality. See, that's how they believe about this. So man, see, it's the center of this materialistic concept. That's why, you know, that's why, like, if you remember, when Vladimir Lenin was the one who started the Soviet Union back in 1917. And see, and because he was so, you know, so revered, they preserved his body in a casket. that you can see publicly. You can go publicly, and they preserved his body for decades, you know, because this is the genius who, you know, created the first Soviet socialist state, you know. And people believe that. There are people around the world who believe that, you know, communism is the way to go. And see, and really, even Marx said this. First you start off with capitalism, then you evolve into socialism, and then you become into communism, which is the perfect utopian state. Right now, there's really no communist, there's no communist country because there's no utopian state, really, all right? But this is what they tried to achieve, see, a classless society. See, where Marx said that the problem was with capitalists, they owned the property. So there's people say, well, we're turning into a Marxist country. No, we're not. You're just too stupid to know what Marxism is. Now, however, if it gets to the point where the government start buying up public land, I mean, not public land, but private land, and saying that people cannot own your property privately, now you know you're into a Marxist state. Because that's what it is over in China. In China, they own the land. However, in the way they got it set up, you can buy a building, or you can erect a building on land. You have to lease the land from the government, but the building is yours. That's yours. And if you want to, you know, go somewhere else, if it's possible for you to move the building somewhere else, you can do that. If you can, you know, but the land, you can't do that. That belongs to the government. And so if you were to sell your building, you can sell your building, but then you have to change the lease of the land. So you have to report to the government and say, okay, I'm selling my building. And so, which means I'm releasing the lease, you know, from the land my building is on, and I'm giving it to somebody else. That's how they do it over there. But again, if you understand what the situation is in the Ukraine, seeing why Joe Biden is over there, because he just happens to be a Roman Catholic, and Putin, see, he's an ex-communist. See, and look, you can Google this. Putin said this. He said the greatest tragedy of the 20th century was the fall of the Soviet Union, and he meant it too. He meant that because he felt that, and like many true communists, they feel that communism is the salvation of the world. See, to get you out under the neck of capitalism, which makes people unequal and slavery and all that. No, we're gonna bring you into this great communist utopia, you know, which just can't happen. It can't happen, you know, because it's human government, and human government is designed to fail. Why? Because it's subject to change. For better or for worse. See, that's the way it is because it's from the human mind and not from Yahweh Elohim. Because Yahweh is the only government that there is, the law of the spirit, and that don't change. And this government was in the beginning and it'll be at the end because it's eternal. See, but man is going to try to do what they can, see. I got a little bit of somewhere, but not as much as I want, but at least I got to the point, at least you can see. Part of the major problem in the world today, as Dr. Kennedy, can I get two more minutes? Go back to the textbook, page 82, and read the last paragraph, and I'll be about done.
Roman Catholic proclamation.
No, the such dogmatism, the second paragraph. Page 82, such dogmatism on the part of the Roman Catholic Church, second paragraph. Second paragraph. Go up above.
Such dogmentation on the dogmatism on the part of the Roman Catholic Church and its reaching to attain ecclesiastical supremacy over the entire world, pitted against the communist aspirations for world conquest by a materialistic supremacy. Has brought the world to the brinks of an universal catastrophe. The lines of battle are not clearly drawn for those who are ignorant of what is going on, but seeing that the Roman Catholic Church, under Pope John VIII,
the 23rd,
and Russia under Premier Nikita
Khrushchev
did not give one inch to one another due to the fact that they both had and their successors have the same goal in mind, world domination. One along ecclesiastical lines and the other along political lines. A world catastrophe is the only possible outcome. Yes, I stated that the lines are not clearly drawn, but if one looks behind the scenes of the conflict in China, the struggle in Africa, the fighting in Vietnam, and the seething in the Middle East, the restlessness of the Americans, he will see the aforementioned forces at work, both of them of the devil, and Satan's kingdom divided against himself cannot stand.
Okay, good enough. All right. Now that's what Dr. Kinley wrote. See, and look, he wrote this 55 years ago. And listen, it's the same situation today. If you look behind the scenes of what's happening in the Ukraine, in the Middle East, in Taiwan, other places, you see these two great forces at work. You know, the Roman Catholic system, which is in Western tradition, the Western tradition, and the communists. See, and the communists, see, like, you say, well, how's it doing in the Middle East? Well, we're backing Israel. That's Western civilization. The former communists, Russia and China, they're backing up the Muslims. They're backing up. Iran is a big partner of Russia, and China is in there, too, backing these people up, you know, with their money. See, the situation in Taiwan. That's the communists. They want Taiwan as an island. We, the Americans, who, you know, backed up by the church or Western civilization, we're for democracy. We don't want to see that happen in Taiwan. See, but it's these different forces at work. It's the same forces. See, one along ecclesiastical lines, another one along communist lines. See, political lines. And they're both of the devil, and they're Satan's kingdom divided against itself. And as Dr. Kinley said, the only outcome that can be is a world catastrophe. However, one more scripture, and I'll be done. Philippians 3:20. And see, and that's the thing that we want to understand. You know, where do we fit at in all of this? You know, are we for this side or for that side? No, man, we're on Yahweh's side, whatever he wants to do. Quickly.
Philippians 3:20.
Yeah.
For our citizenship is in heaven.
That's our true citizenship, not of the world, you know. That's our true citizenship. See, go ahead.
From whence also we are expecting our Savior King, mm-hmm. Yahshua the Messiah,
mm-hmm.
who shall change our vile body that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself.
Okay, see, now that's our true citizenship. See, yeah, like I said, Dr. Kinley said, you know, we will obey the laws of man, you know, yeah, as far as, you know, as long as they don't interfere with our divine right, you know, to worship Yahweh as he really exists. Me putting my hand over my heart, you know, honoring the flag, that's against my belief. That's against my right to worship Yahweh, because you want me to pledge to a physical country. I won't do that. Simple as that. Because my pledge is to Yahweh. He is our banner, see? And that's where our citizenship lies, okay? Thank you very much for your time and patience. We will come back to the subject and we'll get into some other things along with it. But take the time to look and research these things to see if they're true or not. See, you know, Dr. Kinley said it best. He said, look, I drew 7 charts and I wrote 2 books. And in another place, I have given you enough to save you. And in another place, he said, look, read everything because you're going to need it. He ain't talking about, you know, books and encyclopedias. He's talking about these charts. Read these charts. Read everything on these charts because you are going to need it, every iota of it, okay? We hope you were edified as well as enlightened by what you heard today. And in closing, be safe, be healthy, but most of all, be in Yahshua the Messiah. Why? Because he truly is your only hope of glory. And with those few words, hallelujah.
Hallelujah. All righty, thank you there, Dr. Wield. Time is up. It's time to dismiss class. And thank you for tuning in. Those in the other countries, Colombia, Mexico, and England, the Bahamas,
Malaysia,
Australia,
England,
Zambia, Kenya, all those, okay? Thank you for tuning in. We'll see you Tuesday, 7 o'clock to 7 o'clock p.m. to 9 p.m. Okay, Thursday is 7:30 to 9:30. Okay, also you could see on Zoom, you know, follow. Okay, let's all stand, be dismissed. Now to him that is able to keep you from falling, present your faults with his presence with exceeding joy. To only wise Elohim, our Savior, to Yahshua Messiah, sovereign, belong glory, majesty, dominion, and power, both for all time, now and ever.